Hello, Minnesota. Welcome back. Today is Saturday, March 9th, 2013. It is a snowy or slash rainy day here in Minnesota. Welcome back. Thank you for tuning in. This is the Tony Hernandez Show. I'm Tony Hernandez. We have a great show today. Later on, we're going to be talking to Representative Jim Abeler, who's going to talk to us about the Minnesota Healthcare Exchange, his vote on that. We're going to talk about the issues surrounding healthcare, the Affordable Care Act, aka Obamacare, here in Minnesota, and I hope to get some good information for that. Jake is reporting to us live from a remote location right now, so we're going to be talking to Jake and Skyping him in, and hopefully Dallas is going to be able to get our split screen going so that you can see Jake side by side, and he's just going to quickly check in and tell us what he's been up to and what he's doing right now. And we're also going to talk about the filibuster and also a town hall that we attended today. So Jake, can you hear us right now, Jake?
I can hear you, Tony. Thanks for having virtual me in your studio today.
Yeah, there's a first time for everything, and we're moving on up in this show in terms of our technology and being able to increase our footprint out there. So tell us a little bit more about where you are, what you're doing, and what you're up to.
Well, I'm back at the University of Minnesota campus, and today is the State Convention for the Young Americans for Liberty, which is a student organization that's basically a conservative, libertarian-leaning group that is very heavily involved in the political scene on campuses. So they asked me to be a panelist tonight at 5 o'clock, and then after that, they actually have a very wise and very smart man, Tom Woods, coming on to speak to the crowd. He's actually a senior fellow at the Mises Institute, which is a really good economic group down in Alabama, and I'm looking forward to that.
Nice. So what's the mission of the group then? What is it? It's Young Americans for Liberty. Is that what it is?
Right. Yep. They're like a college Republican chapter, but I think they focus more on the liberty aspects, and I think that's probably what they distinguish themselves from the college Republicans on, maybe a little different view than, war and maybe some of these civil libertarian issues.
I see. Do you see any familiar faces in the crowd, people that you know?
Oh, absolutely. But I'm very involved in the political scene here in Minnesota, so I'm not shocked to see a bunch of the people I've worked with in the past on some political campaigns.
Nice. Well, speaking of that, I actually ran into you this morning in your home city of Woodbury for the Representative Andrea Kiefer, Congresswoman Betty McCollum, Representative Joanne Ward, and State Senator, I forgot her name.
Susan Kent.
That's right. Yep. All four of them put on a town hall, and it was actually spearheaded by Andrea Kiefer. She has a town hall once a month in Woodbury just to reach out to her constituents, and she calls it listening sessions. So it's a way that she engages with people, the voters of her district. And so I thought, what did you think about the town hall? It was pretty rowdy there for a while, wasn't it?
It was a little up front. A lot of people are very emotional and have some very valid concerns about what's happening with the federal government, especially when it comes to two items, which I think you heard voice this morning, gun issues and then also on spending. And, I might be sounding like a broken record at this point on your show, but, spending is a big problem out in Washington, D.C., and I think that was vocalized by many constituents of Betty McCollum addressing it to her in person. I thought it was a very interesting event this morning.
No doubt, and I pulled up. I got there. It started at 10 o'clock. I got there at about 9:55, and I pull up, and I'm coming in right at the exact time as Representative McCollum. And so I got to, exchange greetings with her and caught up a little bit. And she asked me actually about the show. She's like, oh, yeah, we know about the show that you have every Saturday. So it's good to know that.
Is she a fan of the show?
She didn't say either way if she was a fan of the show, but she definitely knows about it. And my guess is that people on her staff and tend to tune in maybe here and there, or watch us on YouTube like other people. So. It was pretty good to see her though, and I told her about Leona and I having our first baby, so she was excited about that. And
good.
It seemed though, one thing that I found shocking is that somebody confronted her at the town hall and was talking about how Washington, D.C., how Congress has a spending problem. Sure. And she actually conceded, and I think, Dallas, you have this on tape, but she went and she said that and admitted that Washington, D.C. has a spending problem and that the spending's gone out of control. And she did advocate for tightening the belt in terms of government spending, but you know, one complaint that I have with her over and over, she never offers any specific areas to reduce spending. And that's really what I want to hear about is how are we going to reduce spending? Where are we going to find those responsible cuts and overall, you know, drop the inflation rate as well? What were your feelings about that?
Yeah, I heard the same thing, just generic talk. I hear that a lot from politicians actually on both aisles of out there in Washington, D.C. And that's a real problem because when you spend 43 cents on the dollar, it's actually borrowed. That's very problematic as we go forward. You know, we're really hurting our future generations, our kids and grandchildren. So I would like for them to address this issue right now. And I don't really believe in sacred cows, although I do believe that the per our Constitution, that national defense is the number one thing for the federal government to provide. But I tend to think, you know, there's no sacred cows in this game. If we don't balance the budget, if we don't reduce this deficit spending, what ends up happening is that money is monetized and it hurts everybody, every taxpayer. But most advantageously, it's hurting the people at the lower income levels because they can't keep up with these prices. And it's also hurting our seniors who are now at historic low interest rates, and they rely on fixed income securities for their retirement savings. So I think there needs to be no sacred cow. We need to start making across the board cuts, and those cuts have to be big, not the little ones that they talk about. And even what she mentioned this morning, how we can't do a sequestration. Well, sequestration is so minor of a cut, even though $85 billion to you and I is a large figure. It pales in comparison to the overall spending. In fact, it only equals about 2.4% of yearly spending by our federal government.
Nice. Well, before we let you go, and we're going to try to get you back on the show today before you have to do what you have to do after we talk to Representative Jim Abeler. But I just wanted to get your input quick about the historic filibuster this week with Senator Rand Paul, Senator Ted Cruz, Senator Rubio, and other U.S. senators that stood up to this idea and wanting clarification from the Obama administration, whether they believe they had the power or the right, or if they could envision a scenario where it would be okay to use drone weapon technology on American citizens, on American soil. We already know that the U.S. federal government is involved in assassinating American citizens overseas, who are considered enemy combatants. We've seen that already, so we know that the federal government believes it has the power to do this. But Rand Paul was really bringing to light the issue of whether or not drones could be used on American citizens. And really, that was the whole start of the filibuster. And I mean, what do you think? Were you proud of what he was doing up there in terms of standing for liberty? And
I thought that was a very important question he asked, and he stayed on point. Here, all he wanted was a definitive answer from the administration that they don't believe they can kill a person that's not taking up arms against the United States at that moment. Otherwise, what we need to be doing is arresting somebody, and then every American citizen has a right to due process. And I was just astounded that it took 13 hours for the administration to respond to that very simple question. In fact, it took longer than 13 hours because they waited till the next day to actually give the response. But he got the right response, and I'm glad to see that. Now I think what we need to focus on is the fact that with the National Defense Authorization Act, we can actually illegally detain someone without due process. And that was something that was passed and signed into law by President Obama.
Nice. Well, Jake, thanks for joining us. And Dallas is going to line up some video footage that we have of Senator Rand Paul, the beginning of his filibuster, and then some highlights for the next couple minutes anyways. Thanks for joining us, Jake, and hopefully you're going to be able to join us later. And after watching the video clips, we're going to bring on to our first guest here. So, Dallas, do you have that lined up here? Senator Rand Paul, historic 13-hour filibuster, which started on a blizzard-like day, or I don't even know if the blizzard actually hit in Washington, D.C. that day, but it was supposed to hit. But nonetheless, the filibuster did, so nicknamed the filiblizzard. So we'll play that.
I rise today to begin to filibuster John Brennan's nomination for the CIA. I will speak until I can no longer speak. I will speak as long as it takes until the alarm is sounded from coast to coast that our Constitution is important. No American should be killed by a drone on American soil without first being charged with a crime, without first being found to be guilty by a court. Because when the president responds that I haven't killed any Americans yet at home, and that I don't intend to do so, but I might, it's incredibly alarming and really goes against his oath of office. We have drones that are less than an ounce, presumably with cameras, I don't know, it's hard for me to believe that, but less than an ounce with a camera. It is not impossible to conceive that you could have a drone fly outside your window and see what you're reading, to see what your reading material is. The targeted assassination program that started under Bush and was expanded under Obama essentially grants the executive the power to kill any U.S. citizen deemed to be a threat. I have a message here from, not from the White House, a message saying the White House hasn't returned our phone calls. If anybody knows anybody at the White House and wants to call them, we are looking for an answer from the White House. We've called Justice also. I think the answer says something about the sequester. Maybe they're gonna call me when the sequester is over. And I would go for another 12 hours to try to break Strom Thurmond's record, but I've discovered that there are some limits to filibustering, and I'm gonna have to go take care of one of those in a few minutes here. But I thank you very much for the forbearance, and I yield the floor.
Mr. President.
Senator from Illinois.
Wow. So that was United States Senator Rand Paul, a freshman senator. He was elected in, was he elected in the 2010 sweep? He is standing up for this idea of limited government, and he brought national attention to his filibuster. I know that particular evening, looking on Twitter, on my phone, and on Facebook, all you saw in the feeds was about Senator Rand Paul, about drones, having people discuss whether or not the government should be able to use drones on American citizens, and habeas corpus, due process, our constitutional rights are absolutely number one in terms of what our representatives in Washington, D.C. of the federal government should be standing up for. So I salute Senator Rand Paul for standing up for our freedom, for our liberty, and bringing attention to this important issue. So now I'm going to bring on our first guest. It's Representative Jim Abeler of Minnesota here. And Jim, thank you so much for being on the show. And I actually decided or just give you a call after I heard your appearance on the Davis and Emmer show. The Davis and Emmer show is the morning radio show, and I heard you on that show. I think it was Friday morning that you were on. I was like right outside my work office actually getting ready to go, and I just stood in there because I was fascinated by the back and forth, what you guys were talking about. And for the viewing audience out there that don't know, Jim was the only Republican to vote in favor of the Minnesota healthcare exchange, which for Republicans is a very just clear-cut issue. You know, Republicans have been against the Affordable Care Act, against the idea of the exchange, and you voted for it. So I guess first I'll just give you the floor to explain a little more about when did you decide that you were going to support the exchange, and what were the factors that led you up to it?
Well, ironically, I don't support an exchange. I agree with part of the things that Senator Paul was talking about are the very problems they have in Minnesota. We don't get to run our state. I oppose the ACA / Obamacare. I even was proud of myself in 2007, I think it was, for talking Governor Plenty out of doing an exchange. And so elections happen. Senator Franken was a swing vote, and so Minnesota sent him in a very close race.
Mm-hmm.
Some people couldn't find Senator Coleman to their liking, and so they stayed out of the race. And then, by the narrowest of margins, there he goes off the swing vote, setting up one of the most ridiculous, badly written, poorly done, overbloated, expensive, wastes of money healthcare reforms in the history of our country. And so we were kind of hoping that it would be struck down by the Supreme Court as unconstitutional. It wasn't. We thought, well then, Mr. Romney will win, we'll take the Senate, we can repeal it. Actually, he didn't win, we lost seats in the Senate. And here it is, the law of the land. And coming our way. And our governor made early moves to implement it by executive order. And we thought, well, no problem, we have to pass the law. We still have the House, still have the Senate. Election happened, lost the House, lost the Senate. And now we stand here with our hands empty, trying to fight this thing which is moving forward. And it's no fun to be in the minority. I've been 14 years in office, 14 years and 2 months. Been in the majority twice, the minority twice. The majority is much better. We get to set an agenda. We get to do things our way, at least have a gavel and a place to have a hearing. We can offer our amendments. The governor may or may not take them, but at least we get to have our day and to establish our priorities. When we had the gavel, I was in charge of the Health and Human Services Finance Committee. Worked with the administration. He actually had a reformer commissioner in there. Between us and the Senator Hahn and all the budget crisis of the last 2 years, the net effect of my work there was we reduced spending in Minnesota for Health and Human Services off the growth by $3.8 billion over 4 years. Never been done before. $3.8 billion. About $950 million a year. If you nationalize that, just to talk about spending, if we could nationalize that over a 10-year time and do it across the whole country, it'd be close to a $2 trillion reduction in the federal spending. $2 trillion just from our stuff. And I'm sure you travel far and wide around Minnesota, but in the campaign, the human service area was not an election issue. Nobody died because of our work. In fact, we reformed, we focused, streamlined, got it to work better. That's the joy of being in the majority, and my message to Representative McCollum and all the rest of senators and representatives from Minnesota is do what we did. Cutting $2 trillion, managing $2 trillion, reforming $2 trillion is child's play. Let's get it done. That's $200 billion a year over the 10 years. It's you have to focus and be humane, yet make some choices, and you can do it. And so in comes now the federal, thing, and we have no choice. It's coming our way. We could, I suppose, shoot somebody, but short of an overt rebellion, the Supreme Court has ruled. It's the law of the land. So now what are you going to do? You got this really ugly proposal, from the...
Ugly? What are you talking about? You're talking about...
Oh, the exchange.
The health exchange, okay.
Yeah, and I was one that advocated for doing one 2 years ago in our own way that would be much cheaper, much leaner. Not because I liked it, but because I saw this coming, and my idea was to take out some insurance, pass one, have a sunset provision, so if it becomes ruled unconstitutional or if it gets repealed, then it goes away. And that for the Obamacare ACA has become the third rail of Republican politics, unfortunately. And I don't blame people for not wanting to do it, but it looks kind of good now. Because what we're going to get now is way left, way expensive. It's going to cost it's going to cost $332 million between 2011 and 2016, a third of $1 billion. And the way it's set up now, it's going to cost $112 billion in state money in a biennium, which is a massive amount of money to do what I think is quite little. So back to your question, why would you vote for this? To try to make it better. Otherwise, it's going to go forward with only Democratic influence, with influence from groups like Take Action Minnesota, SEIU, AARP, and they're good people in those groups. But I don't agree with their politics. I don't agree with their idea that everybody should get everything for free forever and that, that dependency makes sense. I'm for people working and being responsible and helping people who need help to get a helping hand up and then mm-hmm. become independent.
Mm-hmm.
And so That's why I did it, and it's become a little controversial, but frankly didn't see any choice.
Yeah, well, controversial is probably an understatement. When I heard the back and forth between you and Davis and Emmer, and Tom Emmer, of course, was a Minnesota State House representative, so I'm sure you guys worked together in the past, so there's an added dynamics to that.
Yeah.
Can you talk, is that the norm? Because, you know, I've heard people, you know, say that you're selling out, that you're a traitor to the party, that, you know, somebody on Facebook, you know, mentioned, you know, ask him what the difference is between, you know, what you're doing and what a Democrat done. Is this something that you're hearing a lot of, and can you talk more about that?
Well, sure. And, you know, all I've got is my vote and my rhetoric. That's all Senator Paul has. So he stood up for 12 hours or more or less and made his point. And maybe he got a letter from the president out of it, but he made his point. And he stood up and he aggravated some of his Republican colleagues. Senator McCain was aggravated. He was our presidential candidate.
Mm-hmm.
But there's sometimes you decide, am I going to help or not? What do I have to offer here?
Mm-hmm.
All he has is his voice. And his votes are irrelevant in the Senate. He's in the minority. All he can do is block stuff, but he can't pass anything. I'm irrelevant in the House unless I can change something. And so to get on the conference committee, which is where the real action is, you have to vote for the bill. And I did premeditate this some time ago. I decided whatever the thing was, I was going to vote for it in an effort to make it better. If it's not good enough, if it doesn't meet the approval of myself and my allies, the Chamber of Commerce, the business partnership, the health plans, MAHU and the agents and underwriters, then I'm going to vote no. But I know I can make a difference. In 2007, I was the only Republican on the Health and Human Services Conference Committee. We did have the governor to back us up, and so I was there knowing that he was going to veto some things. But a lot of things changed because of my ability to rhetoricize and just talk about it and offer a solution. The minute no Republicans are on the conference committee, there's no Republican voice. We can go to the table, and they say, oh, thanks for coming. We're not going to recognize you. At the conference table, where I'm a member, I get to speak up whenever I like and offer points and maybe get some amendments adopted. Mm-hmm. I'm counting on it.
Oh, I remember when the Affordable Care Act was being devised and constructed on the federal level. Of course, you're working with the state on the state level. But one of the complaints I heard from Democrats, from President Obama, from Representative McCollum, was that Republicans weren't taking part at all in any of the reform initiatives at that point because ideologically they were so against this idea of government becoming more and more involved in the healthcare market and whatnot. So my question is back then, so back in 2009 and late parts of 2008 when this was first being devised as the Affordable Care Act, would you have advocated in the same position that House Republicans and U.S. Senate Republicans should have taken more part in the reforms in terms of adding our ideas about being able to buy insurance across state lines, tort reform, and other ideas, good ideas that conservatives had in order to lower the cost of health insurance and also increase coverage? Should they have taken part back then?
I think you always want your voice in the mix. And, you know, there's easy political votes. It's easy to vote no on things that are hot. And it's more popular. But things don't change. I have six sons, and four have played football. When you go to a Friday night football game in a regular Minnesota field and it's a little damp out there, you can tell who the starters are because they're all dirty. You can tell who's on the bench, and they're all clean. They don't even have to take a shower. And so it's ugly sometimes. But I've always kept my eye on the prize at the end. And hopefully people recognize if you can make it better at the end, then why don't you? What I asked Bob Davis was, I said, was the boy who put his finger in the dike, was he wrong? Or is that a great opportunity to watch it go by and then criticize the dike manufacturer and kick out the mayor who didn't take care of it, you know? I didn't get that far into the thing. But to me, it seems if we can make something better that would otherwise be much worse, why wouldn't we?
Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk a little more about what the Affordable Care Act is, what the Minnesota Health Exchange is, and how these two are related. And also, we can talk a little more about what choice was facing the Minnesota legislature, because there are a number of states that have opted to not install the so-called exchange? And so what was Minnesota facing? What was our decision? Was it whether to implement the Minnesota Health Exchange, or what was the alternative?
Okay, well, I can go back in time. Governor Plenty decided not to participate, and he didn't apply for the grants. There were some small grants in the single-digit millions, which he declined. Governor Dayton came on and got all the grants he could get and decided he wanted a state-based exchange. And as this has gone forward, you're going to get an exchange now that it's been adjudicated and mm-hmm. ruled and all that. Every state's getting an exchange. It's just a matter of which one, the federal one or a state one. And you can argue, should we have a state or a federal one? It seems to me that the closer we keep it to home, the better. If you're going to have one, try to design it yourself. That's theoretically the case. Wisconsin and South Dakota, other states are saying, we don't want to even touch this thing. We'll take whatever the feds get, which is ironically not a Republican principle to let the feds run everything. So it's an interesting phenomenon. I'm not even criticizing them. I understand mm-hmm. why they wouldn't. But it's going to cost a fair amount of money. So Governor Dayton decided to do it. We took over the House and Senate. We had the opportunity to pass a bill with caveats and leanness and cheap and frugality, and we declined. That's just simply a fact. And you can argue why or why not, should we or should we not have. It's irrelevant. We didn't do it then. And my leadership was to do it and have it expire if we could get rid of it. Still not liking it, but just defending against the inevitable, that at least it might have come if it couldn't have been, you know, turned down by the Supreme Court. So then the election happens, and we lose both the House and the Senate, and the DFL leadership in both bodies wants a state exchange also. And they have enough votes to control everything. They don't need any Republican votes to do anything on the topic. Not one vote is necessary from us at all. And so they put their planning in place. The Senator Lurie, the DFL senator, and Representative Joe Atkins, the DFL chair in the House, put together a bill from the DFL-run Office of Management and Budget and Commerce and the Department of Human Services. And out came the bill. And it was terrible. It was terrible. There's some main issues with it. If you want to, I can give you a short tick list. There's a risk that it's going to take over the whole rest of the market. There'll be about 1.2 or 1.3 million people in the exchange, everybody on medical assistance, plus 500,000 people or so on private plans. And then there's still a number like that in the private market, in the fully insured market. And then at least we said, well, then leave the rest of the market alone. If you're going to experiment with this new virus, you know, Ebola virus of the system, that's still how I feel about it. I don't like it. Then leave it contained. And they would spread it across the entire system in the name of reform. There's something called active purchaser, which means that this 7-member board, which I'll talk about in a minute, gets to decide who gets to be in, which health company, which plans are offered, because we're just not bright enough maybe to choose on our own. The third thing is the cost, a 3.5% charge against all the insurance plans sold in the exchange, which is $150 per plan. It'll get spread out across the system and be burdened on the small businesses and individuals, a real problem. And the last thing is the board. They've said nobody can be on the board who knows anything about insurance. They have a 1-year bar. The governor appoints them. And they're going to make some foolish choices. Those are some of the main issues. And there's no legislative oversight. Those are the 5 things I'm working on trying to make better. But after all the process, after all the weighing in, those 5 things still are outstanding. Hmm. Big, big deals. Mm-hmm. And so I listened to the senators as they complained about, oh, the game is over. It didn't change like we hoped. And they were wringing their hands and about to be going back to the bench. And I'm kind of happy I'm still in the game. Our side still has a chance to make it better. And if it doesn't work, I'll vote no, and we'll be all no on the bill. And at least we had a shot. Mm-hmm. That's my effort.
Well, I'm wondering, Jake and I were talking earlier about the town hall that we were at, and the Affordable Care Act came up multiple times with Congresswoman Betty McCollum. And my basic instinct is that your average Minnesotan, working Minnesota person, man, woman, husband, wife, employee, senior, whatever, does not understand what the Affordable Care Act is. They don't understand what the Minnesota Healthcare Exchange is. And we simply are listening to rhetoric like from Betty McCollum. You know, she's asked about the Affordable Care Act, and her instinct was, you know, we can't have people with pre-existing conditions being denied care. She talked about stories of people who went bankrupt because of medical injuries or disease that came out of nowhere, and somehow that the Affordable Care Act is going to solve that. And she talked about other kind of, examples that really hit you at your pit of the stomach, because, you know, all of us as Americans, we want to be able to take care of our fellow brothers and sisters. We want to make sure that people have health care. So in relation to the Minnesota Healthcare Exchange, can you just tell the audience a little more in layman's terms, in simple terms, about what is the Minnesota Healthcare Exchange and how is it at least proposed to benefit Minnesotans out there?
Oh, sure. And by the way, you can't legislate based upon some tragic anecdotes, which is how this thing goes. Oh, we have to help this person. Oh, that person. Oh, what a sad tale. You have to have a system. If you're running a business, you have a system. If you have a tax system, you have an overall policy, and you do the least harm to accomplish whatever good you're trying to do. In your business, you market. You don't try to get one guy. You try to get a group. This was designed so poorly. But the idea of the exchange was meant to be there's some good in it. Some Republicans thought it was a good idea in the past, and some governors still liked it. Governor Romney liked it. And it, on its face, it makes sense. Why can't you go online and make some choices and pick from amongst an array of options that I can clearly understand my choices? It will do that. It's also going to send out subsidies to people who make up to $88,000 or $90,000 a year for a family of four to help them buy their insurance. Who can be against that? Except it's paid for with borrowed money, 42 or 43 cents on the dollar. And it's based upon that. So people, when they can dial up and make a choice, and they can use a navigator who will be some nonprofit helper, or they can go to their broker and buy their insurance. For some people, it's not going to help them a bit. For some people, they're going to cost more. And some people will get some discounts because of the subsidies. Mm-hmm. But it's not because the plans will be cheaper. Mm-hmm. They're going to cost more.
Mm-hmm. How about for somebody like me and my wife? We're middle class people living in St. Paul, Minnesota. And right now we get insurance through Leona's work. She's a nurse, so luckily she gets great insurance. But if she ever decided to not work at the hospital anymore, we'd be left to the insurance which my company provides, which is good insurance. It covers what you need, but I've noticed it's expensive.
Yeah.
For a family with children, husband and wife, to be covered, it's $500, $600 per month that comes out of my paycheck. So will the healthcare exchange here in Minnesota, will that help my cause at all, in your opinion?
Well, it depends. I won't ask how much you make, but it's $88,000 for a family of four, mm-hmm. is 400% of poverty, right in that range. It's
okay.
Can you say
that number again? It's
$88,000 or $90,000 a year for a family of four. That's 400% of poverty.
Okay.
The subsidies go from, there's medical assistance, which covers up to about 138% of poverty, which is maybe $14,000 for one person. And then above that, you're in the exchange, and there's a lot of details I could glaze you over, which I will attempt not to do. And so whether you're going to get benefit or not depends upon how close you are to the top. The closer you are to the top, the cost increases because of all the ACA/Obamacare changes are going to more than erode whatever subsidies you would have got. There's a report called the Gruber-Gorman report, which is what mm-hmm. they base their math on. That report says, on some very optimistic numbers, that rates are going to go up 15% to 29% by 2016, just the base rates. So if you're not getting a subsidy, your costs are going to go up mm-hmm. because it has to have guaranteed issue, no lifetime limit, dependents up to 26, et cetera, and many other features that are nice to have, but frankly, they're expensive. You're not going to save any money at all. And a lot of that cost is going to fall on the small businesses that are already struggling to cover anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And more companies will go to defined benefit.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't happen to cover your employees, let's say you have a company of 10 people, or actually there's a cutoff, but if you have a company of 100 people and you just couldn't afford to provide insurance like a nursing home or a restaurant where people make modest numbers and you're barely making it, if you don't have insurance, you have to pay $2,000 per year per person into a penalty fund. Then they can go to the exchange and buy their insurance.
Hmm.
In the nursing home, the long-term care industry in Minnesota, there's about 100,000 people working in there. And those are PCAs and nurse assistants working in nursing homes. It's estimated the impact on that industry alone in penalty is $100 to $200 million a year, and they haven't got the money. And so where it was, some good things were intended, some bad things are coming along. Mm-hmm. There was an interesting anecdote, the SEIU, the Service Employees International Union, full of really good workers and really nice people, but they were big fans of this. They were in Washington lobbying, oh, healthcare for all. One of the contracts just renewed. This year it's up 13% because of this. And their raise wasn't 13%. And they thought just rich people would be paying. But actually, as a lot of us told when this was going through, it's going to trickle down to every man. And so welcome to the reform. Welcome to more costs for health insurance. And some people fear in Minnesota we might actually insure less because of all the changes and the more costs.
Well, that, I mean, that brings up a good point. And in Minnesota, we actually have a very high coverage rate. And I'd have to review the statistics again, but I believe that around 90% of Minnesota residents are covered by some type of a health care. It's about 60% are covered through private insurers, through their employer. A certain percent has Medicare, Medicaid, and MinCare. And right. It's really those 10% of people who aren't covered, my guess is it's their own choice that they're not being covered. And so my fear is, you know, what's really wrong with the system that we have in Minnesota, and why did it need to be replaced? And as you pointed out, the risk is that we're going to ruin our already successful system. What's your opinion on that?
Yeah, exactly. It's the numbers right around 91%. And of the 9% who aren't covered, about half of them could be if they just bothered to fill out a form. But they just choose not to, either through their work or more often through state programs. Hmm. We've been very zealous in going after the uninsured. Minnesota's a leader. And many of the impacts are going to be negative. The providers have to fill out more paperwork. The costs are going to be higher. People are so confused. Small businesses don't know what to do. The brokers don't know. So Minnesota didn't need this. Minnesota's a leader. In every rating of any kind you look at, we're always 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right in the top group for quality and cost. A couple years ago, the numbers, I don't know the new ones, but Minnesota's economy, health economy, cost 12% of the GDP. The federal number was 17 or 18%. We're way ahead of the cost curve. Then this is just going to add, and that's why I've been an outspoken critic of it, and just trying to salvage something good so it doesn't get totally wrecked.
Yeah,
I'm trying to play into the ninth inning.
And speaking of that, you know, I did read the Gruber Gorman report. It's about 25 pages, and you know, I found some of it interesting. And you could see there's some wishful thinking in there.
Wishful,
some
exactly.
Pretty large assumptions.
Yeah.
That are made in terms of predicting the outcome or the consequences of this particular policy. But one thing that I did find interesting is really there's a couple new markets that are being created. And correct me if I'm wrong in terms of how I read this, because I'm still kind of learning about what this is. But you have the reformed individual market, and these are low-income individuals and families that are receiving some type of a subsidy, either from the state or whether it's the federal government, I'm not sure. But then there's another portion of the market, which is the reformed individual market that aren't going to be receiving the subsidies.
Right.
And my question is, one thing that conservatives have been trumpeting and championing in terms of lowering the cost of healthcare is to increase the competition, free up the market, allow individuals to purchase health care, health insurance coverage across state lines, which would ignite a wide variety of different products out there. In terms of, you know, maybe you just get emergency type health care, or maybe you have something catered to your family. Is there an opening for this? Is it just my own wishful thinking to think that maybe we can push an agenda forward within this infrastructure that would free the market up for individuals that choose to want to be a part of maybe like a free market health care exchange that's within the existing infrastructure? Is that not a possibility whatsoever? Like, will I be able to ever call a company in Nevada or Arizona or Florida to get insurance, or am I stuck with whatever Minnesota says that I have to choose from?
Well, two things. One is, eventually two national plans will come to Minnesota, a not-profit and a for-profit one will come in to be in the exchange. By 2017, those two will be coming. I don't know who they'll be. But the other thing is, the word reform in this case doesn't mean Republican reform where you take away criteria. These are added criteria. And so there's commerce already has standards, which are really good standards, and a lot of companies nationally don't meet them. The federal government added some more standards, loss ratios, et cetera, and some criteria, which adds to those. And the exchange board is going to add more standards, whichever ones they feel like. And then the health plans have to compete or get kicked out. Under the current law, they could accomplish all the criteria and still not be allowed to sell, which is really a problem. But so the reform, that's the reform in the individual subsidized market. More criteria, more cost, actually less choices where I can choose to carry more risk, carry less risk. Oh no, we don't trust you to make that decision. The reform market outside is going to be where these same ideas get spread across more. In fact, more rules, less free choice, more cost, and perhaps more uninsured are the risk of that. And it's like, you can't make it up. If we had more rules, it's going to be cheaper. That's what people thought. And 15% at least, and some people say 30, some people say more than that, mm-hmm. in cost by 2016. And somebody has to pay for it. It's not going to fall out of the sky. Those 42 cents, 43 cents in the dollar the feds borrow does actually fall from the sky to Minnesota. Mm-hmm. They created script, they've borrowed money, the Chinese, the Japanese, and the Germans. Mm-hmm. Thank goodness they lend us money. But at some point, somebody has to pay. Mm-hmm. And as SEIU found this year, they're paying 13% more already mm-hmm. for this free money. Mm-hmm. And so beware.
Well, we're almost out of time here, Representative, but thank you for coming on. Would you mind just entertaining a few questions from Facebook people? Because
sure.
I posted something that you were going to be on and asked if anyone wanted to offer questions. So this one's from Tim. It says, ask him why he voted yes to funding the Viking Stadium.
Oh, that's right on our topic. Actually, I was persuaded they would leave, or at least I was persuaded they would shop. Mm-hmm. And I didn't like the money source. Ironically, the assignment was keep the Vikings here and you can't have any real money. Well, we found out there wasn't the real money. So that's a problem yet to be solved, and the poll tabs are not raising what they thought. But I am a landlord in another line of my work, in my private sector stuff, and I know when my main tenants are shopping, I don't want them to shop. And they wouldn't have gone this year or next year, but they would have been going, and we would have wanted them back, and we would have spent a ton of money, mm-hmm. way more than this, to get them back. That's why I voted yes.
Nice. Well, thanks for answering that. The second question is from Joe. He's an Eagan resident. He wants to know, ask him what defines him as a Republican and not a Democrat.
Oh, actually, I can help people understand, even just my ideas across the aisle. If you're driving down the road, you see a guy on the side of the road who's homeless and hungry, we'd probably all give him some food. And we'd maybe take him to our house or take him to a soup kitchen or someplace and get him some food. The Republicans would say, well, you know, what's your plan? Where do you plan to go from here? You know, can we help you get a job? Maybe you need some housing for a while. Let's get you on your feet and get you off to being productive. The liberal people, they see him and they go like, oh, let's get him into a program. Here's a house for you. We're going to buy all this stuff. And the next thing they do is go look for another person who's on the street waiting for food. That's a real difference. And I'm in the first category. If you look at the work I did on human services, we reduced spending by $3.8 billion over 4 years. We made them more focused. People are more independent, more on their own to be reliable. You got to make it work. We're stuck with government. It's not going to go away. I'm a chiropractor in my other day job. One of my patients came in one day. He was a building, a construction guy. He said, hey, I stuck up for the government today. I told my, they wanted to abolish it. And I said, no, we shouldn't. Like, you're not going to abolish it. It's mm-hmm. it's here. So how do you make it work? How do you keep it focused? How do you get it off our back and keep it off our back as much as we can so business can thrive? This last cycle, the Republicans were in charge. We balanced the budget without raising a penny in new money. Unemployment is 2% lower than the Fed's. There's a surplus in 2016 and 17. Every report's been good because of us, because we kept government off the backs of business. We didn't raise taxes. That's how we do it, and that's why I think I'm a Republican.
Thank you. Last question is from John, and I don't know where John lives. But he said, ask him if he can get Tubby fired in an attempt to thwart the sudden influx of mental health diagnosis. He's a Gopher basketball fan.
Well, you know, it's funny, and I did refer on the Davis and Emmer show about playing all four quarters. Maybe if Tubby could remind his staff, his players, there's four quarters in the game. That'd be good, you know. Oh, we're not done yet. No, it's just the third quarter. Play the whole game. And that's what I'm doing in this thing, back to your original question. I'm playing the whole game, doing my best, trying to play through the end and make a difference.
Great. Well, I thank you again, Representative, for coming on the show, and I hope that you come on again in the future and we can talk some more.
So call me up.
Sounds good.
It's a pleasure. Thanks.
Thank you, Jim. That was Representative Jim Abeler on the Tony Hernandez Show. I'm honored to have him here to discuss his vote, the Minnesota Healthcare Exchange. It's a heated topic. People are divided on it. The Republican activists tend to be extremely anti-Affordable Care Act, anti-healthcare reform. And, you know, as somebody who campaigned in the 4th Congressional District, you know, one thing that you do find out when you're going door knocking and when you're going to senior homes and you're going to the nursing homes and you're talking to families, you realize how important healthcare is to people. And it is intricately tied to human dignity. It's tied to liberty, because if you don't have your health, it's very hard in many cases to be free. And the reality of the country that we live in right now is we have a government on every level, whether it's the county, state, or federal government, that spends a lot of money in healthcare, Medicare, Medicaid, MinCare, the whole works. And so I believe that as a party, as conservatives, we need to be more vocal in terms of, first of all, expressing our compassion, and then also expressing our ideas and our solutions that we have from a conservative point of view that will achieve the objectives that we all want to see. We want to see more people covered. We want to see the cost of basic health care lowered so it's more affordable. And we want to see more and more people in the private sector paying for their own insurance and taking care of their own individual health. So thank Jim for coming on the show today. And we're going to tune in back with Jake. And Jake's got a guest as well. And Jake, can you hear us right now? Or
I can hear you, Tony.
Great. That's fine. It's Jake Duesenberg and Walter Hudson. And Walter, welcome to the show. This is your first appearance on the show. So thank you for coming on.
Thank you for having me, Tony. I appreciate it.
Yeah, what did you? What were your viewpoints of that? Did you watch any of the filibuster? Did you pay attention to some of the things that were going on with that? What were you thinking with that?
Unfortunately, I wasn't disposed to watch it on a minute by minute basis, but I was, of course, paying attention to the reaction on social media, Facebook and Twitter. And it's, you know, I think this is something that folks have been waiting for a long time, to see someone in a position like U.S. Senate take a principled stand on an issue like our constitutional rights. So it was a fantastic moment for Senator Rand Paul and for the entire liberty movement.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that. And, you know, it caught the national eye, and it was a bipartisan type issue too, because people were tuning in, tweeting about this, Facebooking about this across the entire country. And he tapped into an issue that, you know, we can all agree upon. We don't want the government droning us, or don't drone me, man, as they say.
Right.
One person I was really impressed with, though, and I have been, is U.S. Senator Ted Cruz. He was there with Rand Paul, and he was on the Senate floor. You know, they did like you can go out there and question, and, you know, the questions kind of turn into somewhat of a monologue or whatnot. But he speaks with such force, such clarity. I think his background is he's a prosecutor, and, you know, the issues that he brought up and the way that he could articulate it, I was entirely impressed. And it brought back these, like, you know, feelings that I get when I'd watch old American Revolutionary documentaries, and just the way people talked about politics back then was so much more intellectually based and philosophically based. And especially in the U.S. Senate, that's the heart and soul and the history of the Senate, is that type of speaking and really delving into issues like that. So I loved it. But, yeah, so Jake.
Yes.
When do you guys have to go? Can you stay for the next 10 minutes or do you have to take off?
Five minutes or so, and then the crowd's going to be wanting us to come in. I can already hear the chants going. Can you?
Yep, absolutely.
How many people are there right now?
I look in the crowd. 100. Yeah, it's well over 100, and we have It feels like celebrities in attendance here. We've got Tom Woods, who's a keynote speaker. Like I said before, he's a senior fellow at the Mises Institute. We have David Gerson, who's running for Congressional District 2 in Minnesota. So there's Marianne Stebbins is with us. Noren Dillon from Republican Liberty Caucus will be here. So we've got a lot of people coming.
Sounds good. And Walter, you made a big impression on people at the the meeting that went on at the Blue Fox. It was a couple months ago, but you had some very interesting viewpoints, and you shared a lot of good ideas and solutions that people were still talking about. So, I think we need to recalibrate here as conservatives, as libertarians here in Minnesota, and perhaps we can talk about that for the next 5 minutes, just a little more back and forth about how we can regain control in terms of the conservative movement, because I'm feeling optimistic. I'm feeling optimistic about our future and our message in terms of it's starting to relate to people. I think some of the negative messaging is starting to weed out a little bit. So what do you think, Walter?
Well, I think to tie it back to your observations about Senator Rand Paul and his filibuster in the Senate, folks are waiting for leadership. You know, people like to follow inspiring messages and inspiring figures. And I think that the key for just thematically, and it's I'm not just in terms of the Republican Party, but the entire spectrum of the right side of the political spectrum, is to just refocus on that core component of individual rights. And that's really all I shared at the panel at the Blue Fox, which was entitled, "Where Do We Go From Here?" The purpose of which was to analyze, what happened in 2012, why did the Republican Party nationally and here in Minnesota take such a beating, and I think a big part of it is a failure to focus in like a laser on individual rights and build our policy prescriptions and our messages on that fundamental point. Mm-hmm. That's what the Declaration of Independence was all about. That's what the formation of the Constitution was all about. It's what our country's history is built upon. If we go back to those basics, the strategy will follow from there.
Mm-hmm. And, just to bring that idea of individualism back to a local issue that we're all facing here in Minnesota right now is the issue of marriage and whether or not the government should step in, the state legislator should step in and change the definition of marriage. And so I'm just wondering what, from your perspective, from a liberty perspective, how does that fit in? And what exactly are your feelings on that?
You couldn't have asked a more poignant question in terms of how liberty applies to an issue of public policy. And my position on that is, to my knowledge, fairly unique. It seems that people usually fall in one of two categories when it comes to the marriage issue. They're either for the state defining it as it is, or they're for the state altering the definition to expand it and include it to another category of relationship. I'm taking a look from a liberty perspective, from an individual rights perspective, at the fundamental idea of the state defining words for us. Now, the state really has no business telling us what marriage is. And we don't seem to have these kind of public policy debates and questions about other words in our culture or other institutions in our culture, because they're defined by the culture. We do it as a community amongst ourselves in voluntary relationships. We define our own families, for instance. Nobody tells us who is part of our family or who isn't. We can regard whoever we wish as close as family. We can bequeath what we own to whoever we wish. And so what I would like to see is the conversation take a turn away from what is the state going to define as marriage to why is the state involved in any way above and beyond simply enforcing contracts between individuals. And that brings it back to that core idea of just looking at, what rights do people have, and government's sole job being to protect those rights. Mm-hmm. The rest can be sorted out by the market and by the culture.
Mm-hmm. Well, why do you think, there's people that cite, there are thousands of laws and statutes surrounding the issue of marriage, and why, from a historical context or from your own opinion, why is the government involved in marriage and issuing marriage license?
Because there's this idea in the culture that one of the jobs of government is to promote good things. And everybody tends to agree on the idea that marriage itself, if you take out the controversial aspect of how we define it, that marriage is a good thing. And so the idea of the state using its monopoly on force to promote that good institution, people perceive that as something that we should be doing. And that's what I'm asking people to question is, whether something is good or bad, does the state have a role in promoting it? Or should the state simply be focused on protecting the rights of the people involved in those institutions?
That's interesting. That's interesting. Well, I'll let you guys get back to your what you're doing over there. And Walter, thank you for making making an appearance on the show. And you're always welcome to come back. And I know you said you have to do some you're watching your kids a lot on Saturdays, but maybe we can set up a weekly Skype where we can get sure. your input on specific issues, especially from a strong liberty perspective, and just to give more perspective to the show, because we're constantly trying to find ways to improve what we're doing here. I know I talked to a gentleman by the name of Thomas Major, T-Mage. She's going to be helping us develop some new music at the beginning, and we're trying to bring in a wider variety of guests and really have a balanced perspective in terms of the issues and the people that we present. Because on our show, we've had Republicans, we've had Democrats, we've had a school board candidate who's seeking the DFL endorsement. We've had people talking about the achievement gap, and we had Jim Abeler on today talking about his vote for the Minnesota Healthcare Exchange. And so, you know, we really want to broaden our horizons here and bring in a lot of different thought, and a lot of different perspectives. So I thank both of you for coming on. Jake, I'll see you next week, hopefully. You're going to be here next week? Or
I'll be in the Caribbean, so I don't think we'll be able to pull that one off.
You're seriously going to be in the Caribbean?
Yeah. I gotta take a vacation every once in a while. I do have a wife, and she won't let me work every weekend.
Nice. Well, yeah, we'll Skype you in Jamaica, man.
Okay.
We'll see you there.
All right, thanks for having us on.
So, that was Jake and Walter Hudson joining us from afar. That was actually our first Skype broadcast. And, you know, excited to do that. And we're going to bring in more and more. I have some people from across this country that actually want to take part in this show. And so we're going to really try to diversify it in terms of getting different people in here. So, again, I'd like to thank all of you for tuning in. I'd like to thank my guest, Representative Jim Abeler, for coming on. If you could, we always ask you that if you could share this video on your Facebook page or tweet it out, the YouTube link. We're just trying to get the word out about the Tony Hernandez Show. We broadcast live every Saturday from 4 o'clock until 5 o'clock. We're at SCC Television Studios in White Bear Lake, Minnesota. And then we broadcast it worldwide on YouTube. So, and then also we replay it every Saturday at the same time from 4 o'clock until 5 o'clock on SPNN television. Right, Dallas? Are we still still doing that? So, yeah, but I'd like to just quickly bring on my wife here who's been sitting here. Come here, babes. This is actually her first appearance because she hasn't been feeling too hot lately. But
thank you.
Leona, if you just want to say hi to everybody and...
Hi. <laughs> So
have you been feeling a little better, my pregnant wife?
A little better this past week, yeah.
Yeah, this is the first time you've mustered up the energy to come on here. Sorry for putting you on the spot, too. But, yeah, we just wanted to say hello, everybody, and thanks for joining us on the show. This is the Tony Hernandez Show. May God bless you. May God bless America. And vaya con Dios.